I accidentally broke my bathroom mirror while I was getting ready for work. My dad always said that's 7 years of bad luck, but I know it's a silly superstition. This probably only lasts 7 hours, but it might be a good idea for me to take the day off. What do you think? No. Alright, now with Case, Beasley, Vickers, Moser, and Sandstrom, hopefully we can get a few things done and make headway with our investigation. Since everyone is here, we're going to have the same group, with the exception of Trebdor. We might be... Actually, we might rework things. One moment. Actually, I think I'm going to pair up Trebdor and Birch. Maybe Birch can be somewhat decent. We can use them for minor things, or break them up and use them for more serious opportunities. They'll be kind of our flex squad. Tomorrow's the deadline to hire female cops. Now with our investigations, we still need some more frames on this one. So what we're going to do... We have Case and Cross on there. So what we're going to do is we're going to keep Case on this particular case. And we're going to move... Since I think we're almost done on that. And we're going to move... Moser onto this destruction of property. Disorderly conduct. The elderly Emma Weston called in a complaint about her neighbors. Her house is shaking from loud sounds of gnashing metal and the roar of turbines. Accompanied by some strange beeping noises, through the window she also saw people moving around. This seems pretty vague, so we're gonna send just Trebdor and Birch here to deal with that. A hostage situation with a fatal casualty. Patients at the local asylum rebelled against the nurses during breakfast. Three nurses have been wounded while others remain locked in with the patients in the dining area. They're threatening to kill one nurse every hour until their release. We are going to send SWAT, as well as Stovall, Robbins, Gibbons, and... Sorry, Stovall, Samd, Givens, and Truve. Success with Trebdor and Birch Jr. We might make Birch Jr. a good officer yet. The Vargas need help. Mr. Varga introduced us to a man named Bob. Bob can get us any weapon we want, so we like Bob. But his neighbors just called, saying we saw some strange man in the house, one of them carrying a knife. We want Bob alive. Is that sort of thing the police can help with? We're gonna hold off and make sure there's a Sam's one here to balance that out. Reports and onlookers have gathered around the building. Their asylum patients are watching the growing crowd from the windows of the third floor. We're gonna call in a negotiator. And that did it. Because we need to at least make sure we help the Sands once just to keep things on an even keel before we can help any more Vargas. We want to do as many Varga missions as possible, but have to be careful. Reckless endangerment. A frightened woman phoned in reporting that two men dressed in armor were running through the street shouting, "Beware our stings!" They were chasing passers-by and swirling their blades at them. They're not done anyone any harm, but their swords seem dangerous enough. Sounds like LARPers to me. We'll send in Robbins and Huff, and Birch Jr. as the backup. Success. Here we go, the Sands. An old friend is visiting Mr. Sand, and they're planning on going horseback riding. But the owner of the country club just called. It wasn't making much sense, but sounds like some punks are beating Mr. Sand's horses to death. We'll send Trebdor to deal with that. Now we're on an even keel. Okay, the Vargas need help. After Sand smashed up all of our sports cars, Mr. Varga promised us new ones. Today, the first of them arrived at the port. We wanted to go pick them up, but some assholes locked Tommy in his car and picked it up in the air with a crane. Tommy's shouting like he's about to die. We'll send in Birch Jr. And so we'll definitely have to help the next Sand if it pops up. Noise complaint in the ghetto. Klim Yuryev reports that suspicious people are constantly going in and out of the apartment next door. They're carrying big bags, making lots of noise, screaming, and his three sons can't concentrate on their homework. Mr. Yuryev urges someone's got to show these bandits who's boss. We will send Gibbons, Truve, Robbins, and Huff. I should have waited to help that Vargas, because I bet you another Sands isn't going to show up now. And then that's 2 days where the Vargas are leaving. Not good. Oh, we got kind of lucky with the Sands needing help. A whole mob of Vargas people attacked the truck belonging to one of our companies. This truck is carrying some important cargo, the kind only Mr. Sand and his deputies know about. The driver tried to call us, but we lost the connection. He may be already dead. Gotta stop those assholes before they make off with the goods. Okay, we're going to send Vandel, Grant, and Trebdor. So now we're even. Success on the noise complaint. And we found an automatic weapon, which we will bring to the police station. We have 3 new frames for the destruction of property. And the hit and run, we didn't find any new frames. That is not good. All we can do, very quickly, is to see if this red one will do it for us. So, it was a red car. I guess a dark red is a type of dark car. We should have done that before wasting any of our time, but what can we do? William Holden frequents the local bars, repeated address for driving under the influence. Go at Kevin's Throat Bar. We will send Stovall and Samdi to arrest him. Let's look at our other investigation for the destruction of property. Let's assign... Well, let's see if we can't solve it first. So, destruction of property. A young drunken biker broke into the church, rode around between the pews, defiled the sacred crucifix, and fled the scene. Clara Mason, parishioner. I've been going to Sunday service for 36 years, and this is the first time I've ever seen such a disgrace. Some crazy young man on a motorcycle drove straight through the doors of God's temple and began running around, shouting blasphemy. He even dared to raise his hand to the Holy Father Nunez. To Holy Father Nunez, what is with the youth of today? Jerome Nunez, Holy Father. It all happened so quickly. The guy drove straight between the pews, almost crushing a parishioner. Then he looked into the confessional and threw in a bottle. And then he ran up to me and shouted, "The devil sits on the roof of the church." Then he shoved me. I fell to the floor, and the crazy man shouted, "My hand is hard as stone. I'll knock you out of the saddle, Satan." And then he threw his helmet at the cross above the altar and sped away. Thomas Cruz, parishioner. I was in the confessional when it happened. I was waiting for Father Nunez to finish his sermon so he could hear me. I had sinned so much this week. As I was sitting in the confessional, I heard noises of an engine like a motorcycle. Then there was a roar and a man shouted, "Come, Lucifer, do not hide from me." A few seconds later, a young man in a black leather jacket opened the door of the confessional and yelled, "I will seek out the devil wherever he may be," and then he threw a bottle at me. The shard struck me in my face. At the crime scene, we found a black helmet with a white spot on top. And on the pavement near the church, we found traces from three motorcycle tires. Which means... this looks like two. And that looks like three. So, he sped through the... he went in through the front doors, sped through the pews, threw a bottle... or did she push? He threw the bottle, then he pushed the father, then he threw the bottle. Nope. Bottle first, then pushing, then the helmet with the white spot as he threw the helmet at the cross above the altar. There we go. Gregory pulls in biker. Doesn't look like we can arrest him until the next day. But in the meantime, let's focus all of our detectives now on this theft. Oh, and it looks like the destruction of property. Gregory Polson continued pursuing the devil to the bottom of a glass. So let's send in Gibbons and Truve. And since it's the end of the day, just in case, we'll throw in SWAT as well. Although it didn't seem like he was... we'll just send in the officers. We did manage to catch the offender. That's excellent. Good. Case closed. And we managed to catch the offender for the destruction of property. Able to arrest all subjects. Let's end the day. And now the Sands and Vargas are tied at 8. Alright, it doesn't look like anyone called in sick, which is excellent, and everyone seems to be in good spirits. Let me just double-check my notes to figure out who's assigned with who, and we'll start the day. Okay, so our partners are Koshi and Tsubaki, Yancy and Asano, Purdy and Scott, Alejandro and Austin as per usual. Dixon here is going to act as some very skilled backup if necessary. Of course, we have our detectives Newberry, Cross, Mole, and Armstrong. Let's start the day. So, Gregory Polzin turned out to be a member of a gang known as Wheels of Empire. He could help you take down the gang if you make him an informant. Absolutely. If you must go, sweet mama. Alright, so we're now going to go up the chain and investigate Anton Tretyakov. We're going to have Newberry be on the lead on this one. But right now, we do have some cases here on this theft. We do want to put everyone we can on it right now, with the exception of Newberry. Then once this has been closed, we'll focus on the gang. Rape. Jim Batten Bakery. Two homeless men made their way into a local bakery under cover of darkness, where they ate their fill and bedded down for the night. In the morning, the bakery owner, Gregory Martinez, along with cashier Anna Lucas, went inside and discovered the damage. The homeless men, armed with knives, were unhappy to be disturbed and attacked the victims. Shopkeeper managed to escape, but the cashier remained inside with the homeless men, who were seen tearing off her clothes. Okay, all hands on deck on this one. Koshi, Tsubaki. We're also going to put in Scott and Purdy, along with Dixon as backup. Let's see here. Maybe I should have Yancey and Asano instead. Yeah, they're a little bit... they have a little bit more experience. Yancey and Asano. Now, we are tied with the Sands and the Vargases as well, so we want to maintain that tie still. Jack, you swore an oath to serve the city. If you can't keep your promises, we won't keep ours. Yes, we didn't. We decided just to hire based on merit, and that's not on gender, so we have a problem there. Next request is in 2 days. The Sands need help. After the incident with the horses, we secretly transferred Mr. Sands' guests to a local hotel and set up a guard outside his door. Suddenly, we're hearing screams coming from his room, and there's water flowing from the bathroom. We'll break down the door, but police presence won't hurt. Yeah, we're going to help out the Sands with this one. We're going to send in Alejandro. The investigation has started on an armed robbery, so we're going to wait till we get some more frames, then we're going to go through the clues together. Thankfully, no one was harmed. We have a fight at the Blitz Cafe. Two truckers fell to blows over a parking space in the lot near the diner. The cook tried to separate them, but was struck by a wild punch and is now lying on the ground motionless. Let's send some officers. Let's send Purdy and Scott. I guess Scott has more stripes. And then we'll also send in Dixon as well as backup. As well as Austin, I suppose, just because her partner is out dealing with the Sands, and we still have two groups here. We now have a theft at St. John's Hospital. All the painkillers at the hospital pharmacy disappeared shortly after the building lost electricity. The pharmacy door shows no sign of forced entry. We'll have Cross lead that one. Let's check the frames here. We don't have enough frames on the theft, unfortunately. Now the Vargas need help. We were putting on a small concert in the park, but during the break, someone noticed that there was a bomb under the stage. Everybody's afraid to move in case they set off the bomb. Please send someone to help. All right, Alejandro, you're up again. That will tie us once more. We want to keep... Good. We want to keep the Sands and the Vargases tied as long as possible until the very end, until we'll finally give some final support to the Vargases to push the Sands out. Same thing with this particular theft. We're going to wait till we get some more frames. Amy Marbin, Donatello. Jack, my entire staff at the donut shop came down with the flu, and I haven't been able to find anyone else to help out. Could you please send me a couple of your men? I'm sure they wouldn't mind frying up some donuts. It's easy, I'll show them everything they need to know. My shop barely makes ends meet, so I can't afford even one day of downtime. Of course, this is helping the community. Great, this is also greasing Jack's pockets. We're going to save our officers for police work. Try to make City Hall as happy as possible, what with the not hiring just female cops thing. We're going to let that one time out. Because, for those events, the cops are gone the entire day. Now the Sands need help. We need backup. Some punks tried to crash one of our poker games, and we aren't able to let them walk with the money. So now we've got ourselves a standoff. A couple officers on the scene would change the situation in our favor. So we can help the Sands, but then we'd have to help the Vargases again. We'll continue on. We'll throw in Alejandro and Austin here. Just have to remember the Sands are up by one. We want the Vargases to be assisted as well. Public indecency. The last picture show theater. During a special viewing of the thriller Law Abiding Max 3, a theater employee discovered one of the members of the audience had removed his pants. The man noticed the employee was watching him and responded with the threat that he would cut the throats of everyone in the theater. Okay. Let's send in Purdy, Scott, and Dixon as backup. I just want to quickly check our police station and see if we have any open slots. We do not. Now the Vargases need help. We were supposed to keep an eye on this house where Mr. Varga keeps some important documents. We were here just 5 minutes and already the house is on fire. At least help us get those papers out of the house before the whole thing goes up. Okay, we're going to send... 38? Or guess who we're going to send, Alejandro? It's going to be you. She's pretty much our cleanup person.
Looks like we have a situation here.
Oh boy. The movie theater isn't too crowded and the film is in full swing. We're going to turn on the lights and take aim at the offender.
214 complete.
There we go. So we're gonna just wait for Alejandro to come back. In fact, we're gonna send Austin since they're literally just gonna be carrying paperwork. Vandalism. A man who wished to remain anonymous reported that a group of teenagers had once again made fun of his name by writing insulting rhymes on his 6-foot-wide garage. The man is enraged and threatened the next time he'll use a weapon to defend his honor. Let's send in a couple pros to calm him. Yancy and Subaki. Alright, three new frames for the armed rock. And three new frames for the theft. So let's look at this. Alright. Ralph Campos, museum guard. I walk the museum every hour. The alarm is off. City Hall won't allocate the money to fix it. I didn't hear the glass breaking. It's a big museum. When I went down this way again, it was already early morning. The window was broken, and the canvas was cut from the frame. There was no trace of anyone around, just a brick lying on the floor. The parking lot was empty all night. In the morning, a cyclist went past with a tube on his shoulder. The guy slowly rolled into the parking lot, then left the bike for a couple minutes, and then went out of sight. Then he came back, got on the bike, and left. Bram Vanderhoff, art school student. I suffer from insomnia and often go cycling around the city late at night. I took a tube and some other equipment so I wouldn't have to go back home before my morning classes at the art school. I stopped at the museum to pee. I admit it. I like to mark the corner of the building. I imagine one day my work will be hanging inside. Jeremiah Stevens, teacher at the art school. In his lectures on the works of the Dutch masters, Bram Vanderhoff always sharply criticized the works of de Vroom. He dismissed the legendary artists as overpriced mediocrity and was very amazed when an unknown de Vroom painting was discovered in the city, when this painting was discovered in the city dump. He said it was already in its proper place. He was less amused when he learned that the de Vroom painting would be hung in the museum. I wouldn't be surprised if it was Bram who broke into the museum and stole the painting, to burn it or cut it into tiny pieces. The glass is almost completely broken out. A grown man could easily climb through the window and not cut himself. Most of the shards are lying on the pavement outside the museum. But it looks like we have two suspects. The student, and then the guard himself. We have three frames of each, which is interesting, but we're still missing a part of the picture. We're going to have to continue to investigate. We have as many detectives as we can on this. And not enough frames on either of the other cases, just yet. Oh, good. Versus 10. Alright, Newberry and Cross are a little bit tired, but everyone else is doing just fine.